Lawrence says, with a cyclone sitting near our coast, extremely high humidity has exacerbated my benign prostatic hyperplasia problem. Now I add 12 ounces of black coffee to my morning fast, making me want to take a sip of mine. Now I add black coffee to my morning, 12 ounces black coffee to my morning fast. I started skipping breakfast recently to combat persisting high serum LDL. Fasting LDL-C as high as 305 milligrams per deciliter in recent years. Well, we're going to have to come back to that. My theory is that skipping breakfast would help towards losing weight. It could if it leads to a sustainable caloric deficit, which is how everyone loses weight. It's one tool, but you have to test it. I think adding coffee consumption during the fast not only help suppressing inflammation, but also stimulates LDL-C production, or is it just free fatty acids? I believe this may reduce the serum LDL-C level by the time I go for another fasting blood lipid test. I want to improve my lipid profile just to please my doctor. You should want to improve your lipid profile for a lot more than to please your doctor. 305 milligrams per deciliter is, look, if you want to, let's revisit this from a cholesterol skeptic point of view. There was a graph in, actually, let me see if I can pull this up on the screen here. If I can do it quickly, I'm going to do it. Okay, I cannot do it quickly. All right. So let me reference one of the early cholesterol skeptics, Uffe Ravnskov. He wrote a book called The Cholesterol Myths. And in that book, he shows a graph from the Framingham study where he's making the point that most people who have heart disease are all in the, they're all overlapping with between, excuse me, he maps out the people who have heart disease and the people who don't. And so this is going to appear, I'm going to try to do this backwards so it looks normal to you in the video. The people without heart disease go up in a curve like this. And then the people who have heart disease go up in a curve like this, and it's just slightly shifted over. And he makes the main point that in the vast majority of people there have overlapping cholesterol levels. And so in fact, you know, most people with heart disease just have normal-ish cholesterol levels and that are not that different from people who don't have heart disease. But if you look at that graph, one thing that you see is that the people with heart disease have this little tail that goes over, it's like a little tiny lump that goes over way up on the high end of the cholesterol amount as you go from left to right. And what that little hump is that everyone who had total cholesterol over a certain point, cutoff was around 300, had heart disease, and no one who didn't have heart disease had cholesterol that high. And similarly, there were, on the other side, there were, you know, there was also a little hump on the other side where everyone below a certain cholesterol level didn't have heart disease. So if you're, look, the only way you can possibly have cholesterol, fasting cholesterol that's over 300 milligrams per deciliter is to have a familial hyperlipidemia, such as familial hypercholesterolemia, or to have a very significant thyroid disorder. And, oh, okay. He clarifies, my apology, total cholesterol is 305, LDL is 205. I did not, fine, it literally makes no difference. The only way you can have a total cholesterol, and in fact, that's what I was saying before, the total cholesterol over 300 is, that's somewhere around the cutoff where everyone above that had heart disease. So look, the only way to have a total cholesterol of 300 or more in most cases, is to either have a thyroid disorder or to have a familial hyperlipidemia. When we're talking about fasting levels here, So you should want to manage your blood lipids for your own sake, because people with familial hypercholesterolemia have a dramatically increased risk of having heart disease decades earlier than it becomes normal for the general population. And so I'm not saying it's 100% that if you have a cholesterol of 300, you have heart disease, but you are way disproportionate in risk for that reason. So you definitely want to address this not to please your doctor, but for the sake of your health. Okay, going back to the question. I also added plain yogurt and ginger to my diet to alleviate my prostatitis situation, which appears to be worsening chronic inflammation. Is there anything else nutrition-wise I should pay attention for the time being? Okay, so I can't speak to the relationship between humidity and benign prostatic hyperplasia because I don't know enough about prostate health in general, but including benign prostatic hyperplasia, to even know why the humidity affects it or what to do about it. But I can definitely speak to the blood lipids. So okay, we're talking about coffee consumption, intermittent fasting, and total cholesterol being over 305. So I don't know. I mean, okay, let's take these things one thing at a time. So intermittent fasting, can it help you lose weight? Yeah, it can. Not particularly any better or worse than any other thing that results in a sustainable caloric deficit. So if intermittent fasting is a useful way for you to be able to sustain a caloric deficit that helps you do it in a way that's more sustainable or easier to accomplish than any other way, then I think that it should be fine to do that. I think that's a fine way to do it, but don't be fooled into thinking that intermittent fasting has any particularly special value to allowing you to lose weight. I think that if you have weight to lose, that losing weight should be one of the first things that you do to normalize your blood lipids and your inflammation. And so if you have weight to lose, I would make that your overwhelmingly single project for now. And then when you get to your optimal weight, I would start chipping away at some of these other issues. Being overweight causes inflammation. Inflammation causes your blood lipids to go up. Inflammation, I'm sure, probably contributes to the prostate issue as well. So if you can reduce the inflammation by reducing overweight, then I think that should be the number one thing that you do. Being overweight also contributes to elevated free fatty acids, and elevated free fatty acids do raise your blood lipids. That's, in fact, the entire rationale of using high-dose niacin to lower LDL-C is by suppressing free fatty acid release. So losing weight, becoming insulin sensitive, and when you lose weight, once you become insulin sensitive, working carbohydrate into your diet, all of those things will help target the blood lipids on that end. In terms of other things that you can do in this situation, I think addressing any inflammation in your gut. So you might have microbiome issues, working with someone who specializes in the gut to assess and address any gut issues. If you can't find someone, or while you're waiting to find someone, simply consuming a lot of vegetables, as long as your gut tolerates them and you don't get GI symptoms, with that proviso, working more high fiber vegetables into your diet and diversifying across the different plant fibers is a great way to nourish your microbiome, reduce inflammation that comes from the intestines that would negatively affect your blood lipids. But I do think that you need to look at those, and I'll put a link in the show notes. Check out the podcast that I did on dietary management of familial hypercholesterolemia. If these things that we just talked about aren't enough to get the blood lipids into the normal range, then I think you want to experiment with the ideas that I laid out in dietary management of familial hypercholesterolemia, which in the context of achieving ideal weight and insulin sensitivity would involve eating more carbohydrate and a low-fat diet, but selecting those foods to maintain nutrient density. And you could add something like psyllium husk fiber, which might be both good for your gut and the inflammation coming from your gut, and will also help reduce your cholesterol by making bile acids go into your feces and making your liver draw out cholesterol from the blood. If those natural things don't get your blood lipids into the normal range, then I think that you should consider being open to pharmacological methods, because I genuinely believe, like, look, I've gone through all the cholesterol skeptic literature, I'm against demonizing cholesterol. I do not believe that high cholesterol is the cause of heart disease. But if your lipids are that high, it's overwhelmingly because you are not clearing them from the blood, and not clearing them from the blood is the single most important risk factor for them oxidizing, and them oxidizing does cause heart disease. So I really do think that try all the natural things first, but if they don't work, be open to the pharmacological methods. I mean, this might be a case for statins. So, all right. Thank you, Lawrence.